So, interaction diagrams. There are two different kinds of interaction diagrams. You have your sequence diagrams and you have your communication diagrams. Sometimes you'll hear collaboration diagrams as well, which is the same as communication diagrams. Sequence diagrams you've seen already in the form of system sequence diagrams. These are just a special case of the sequence diagrams, and the only difference is that you're using them in a different place. You're using them earlier on. You're not looking what's happening inside the system, and you're using a slightly simplified syntax. You're not using all of the features that you can have in a sequence diagram. I'll go through a small example of a sequence diagram and of a communication diagram, just so you get a feel of how to do them. Okay. Right, so I had this one. Start with, I have some boilerplates just to get myself started. We have a couple of participants in this sequence diagram. We are making a coffee machine, and what happens inside a coffee maker once we start brewing a cup of coffee, and all the different objects that collaborate. Notice that it's objects. You have the colon here. So it's instances of all of these different classes. The first thing that happens is that the coffee maker does something. And I've done a shorthand here as well, so to simplify life for me. The coffee maker sends something to the brew unit. This, as you notice, is looks like a normal method call, like you would write in code. So we have a method, make coffee, and we pass along parameters, the size of the cup, the type, if we have different types of coffee, and any extras, milk, sugar, etc. Compile this and see what we get. Yes. So we have the coffee maker, which is a facade for the system or the user interface or something. Sending the method called make coffee to the brew unit. And brew unit will act as a controller in this scenario or in this sequence diagram. We activate the brew unit, and in the end, we're going to deactivate it. What this means is that we indicate on the lifeline of this object that we're inside a method call here, and things are going to happen inside this method call until we're done. Okay, so inside this method call, what we will do is that we'll tell the water boiler that it should start boiling water. Brew unit to water boiler. And it should heat a certain amount so that we have enough for the cup of coffee that we want. This will activate the water boiler, and later on we will deactivate the water boiler as well. Which means again, it's inside a method in the water boiler. We will also, and I'm cheating a bit here, there is a specific syntax for doing asynchronous method calls, but this is sufficient to get the idea. The brew unit will also tell the grinder that it should start grinding. A certain cup size and a certain type of coffee. So what we have so far, we tell the water boiler to start heating, and we tell the grinder to start grinding. We need to know when they're finished, which we can do now. We can put the water boiler back to the brew unit. And we can tell the grinder to do the same thing with the grinder. Alright. This one can't be here because we have deactivated the grinder. We need to put that one there. There are two different ways of doing a return of a method call in sequence diagram. You can either put it on as a return to a variable on the calling line, or you can put it on a dotted line going backwards like here. Here it's not a return value as such, it's some sort of notification back that we're done here. Just to show you what we could do like this. This means that the grind method returns some sort of value, which we store in the status variable, which is local to at least this method, the make coffee method inside the brew unit. It could also be a member attribute for the entire class. We don't know that with this information, but we know that whatever we get from the grinder should be stored in the status attribute. Clear that again. So now we've boiled water, we've ground the coffee, and we can tell the brewer to actually brew. When this activates the brewer and it deactivates the brewer. Same thing here. Once we're done, we need to know that yes, we can now continue. It's not strictly necessary, but it in this case, but it gives clarification if nothing else. And once we know that we have brewed coffee, we can start pouring it, and we do that with the help of the mixer. Activates the mixer, and we can actually let's call the other method as well. This is again strictly not kosher syntax wise, but it conveys the idea, which is always the main thing, except on the exam, because then you have to worry about doing it right as well. Any milk and coffee, milk and sugar that we want to add, we add that here. So what do we have? We have, oh yes. The facade calls the make coffee method to the controller, the main controller, brew unit, which heats the water. Grinds the coffee. I see that this one, the water boiler, should probably be done once it says that it is all done. Over here then. Try again. Better. So we heat the water, we grind the beans, and once we're done with that, we brew the coffee, and once we're done with that, we pour the coffee. We pour the extras, and in the end, we probably want to say same thing here. That we are all done. So the brew unit knows that we are now finished with the coffee. I can go back to sleep. Excellent. There is more syntax. If you look in the book, you'll see that you can add boxes around and do iterations and conditional stuff as well. I'm not going to go through that. You can read it about it in the book, but this is to give you the general idea at least. Now, If we want to do this as a collaboration diagram instead, I'm going to just to show that they are actually collaboration diagrams and sequence diagrams are actually exactly the same, or communication diagrams. So I'm going to start with the same code and I'm going to transform it into a communication diagram just to really hammer down the point that this is the same thing. First thing that we need to do is that we need to change the syntax. These are no longer participants, they are objects. Okay, the method calls is still the same, but we don't have the lifelines. We don't know for how long different methods live, so we need to comment those away. Let's see, we do that with, like this. Beginning of line, anything starting with AC, and we replace that with the comment line. Good. And then the same thing with the deactivation things. Okay. Comment the way activate and deactivate. Now we can actually compile this. Looks horrible, doesn't it? But we can see that it's a different kind of diagram, at least now. We can make this slightly better by adding a few more lines to that one, and here and down here as well. The only thing I'm doing now is that I'm giving hints to plant UML that these should be on a second line rather than on the same line. The all done messages, they don't make that much sense anymore. So let's remove them. Like this, and then anything, and then a second group. Right, and then comment on the first group and the second group. Compile and see what we have. Good. Removed all the all done messages. Regular expressions, they are a pain in the behind to learn, but once you do know how they work, they can be really powerful. Right, the next thing we need to do is we need to say the order, because as you look at if you look at this picture, you see that there is no order anymore. You don't know in which order the brew unit first. Does it grind the beans first? Does it heat? Does it brew? Does it pour the coffee or whatever? So what we need to do is that we need to restore this order. And we do that by putting numbers on the method calls. This gives me or gives us the order. So the first thing that's going to happen is we make the coffee, then we heat, then we grind, then we brew, pour coffee, pour extras. We can nest this as well. So let's say inside the mixer, if we have something else that happens in there with the pour extras, let's do something here. So inside the mixer, we check with I don't know what a new object. We have a milk container. And we check if we have milk available. Like that. We can now either do this by just inserting a number, but then we don't know we don't know if it's going to happen as part of the pour coffee, method call or as part of the poor extras method call. So we'd add a nested number like this. And this tells us that as part of the poor extras method, so while that is being executed in the mixer, it's going to execute another method call inside the poor extras method to the milk container to check availability. Okay, that's what I was going to say about communication diagrams. As you notice, this is exactly the same as the sequence diagrams. It's laid out in a different way. It's slightly more focused on the communication between the objects rather than the lifelines of the objects. It's slightly more space efficient. That's why you see it quite often in the book. But it's a matter of taste whether you prefer sequence diagrams or communication diagrams. Okay, and that's what I was going to say about communication diagrams and sequence diagrams. And you can start wondering now and practice for on your own. How would you take this and then start creating a class diagram out of it? But that's something that I'll cover in my next video.